There are so many dishes that I wanted to make for the judges. Firstly, I really wanted to make an Indo-Chinese dish for them, which I couldn't make. The other dish that I really wanted to make was lal mas.
A very special guest joining us, Dipinder, or Pindo as she was fondly called, on the show, talking to us about the inspiration she takes from her roots, of course, of having grown up in India, then of course the Australian experience as well, the backstories, what happened in the MasterChef, what she wants to do from here on as well. Dipinder, it's great to have you with us. We've had a back and forth for weeks to try and get you, but it's great to finally be chatting with you. Let's begin with, of course, it's all in the middle of a pandemic. You spend so many weeks in the kitchen. Unfortunately, you're out now. But how are you liking being home with your family once again?
Firstly, thank you so much for having me on your show. It's been an absolute privilege. It is unfortunate that I'm out of the actual show, but honestly, it's so nice to be back home. I was away from home for about 6 to 7 months. And I think it was getting to a point where I had really started to miss my family. And I think all these factors really play in when you're competing in a competition of, you know, of that level, like MasterChef is in here in Australia. So as tough as that was and as stressful as it was, it's really, really nice to be back home. You know, I feel so relaxed and so chilled out all the time. You know, I'm not racing across the kitchen. I cook, I take my time. I'm not rushing. So I'm really making the most of my time at home right now.
But Dipinder, you know, what has been really fascinating to see in this season has been, you're not the first contestant who has some sort of Indian roots or heritage. But ever since the season started, you really became the focal point where everybody was talking about what you were doing with your dishes, how you were innovating. Did you kind of at any point expect such a great overwhelming response?
No, I didn't. And I say this all the time, and I was talking to my husband earlier today, and I told him as well, I was like, I did not expect even like 5 to 10% of the response that I've received. And I don't think I understood how big MasterChef Australia is in India. I had no idea. Like, for me, it is a really big deal because I'm a home cook and I come from India, and I lived, you know, I spent a decent part of my childhood in New Delhi, and then I moved to Australia. So I know what it means to me to get that support, get that fan base in, you know, in a country where there is so much going on at the moment. And, you know, I'm just fortunate enough to have, you know, like a tiny little bit of attention, and it's, you know, and the messages I received, some of the photographs
I received. It was a tiny bit of attention. It was a lot. And I can tell you back home, we've been discussing this. You know, the kind of fan following MasterChef as a brand itself has built over the years. You feel so connected with the judges, with the contestants. And of course, if you have somebody from your own roots, of course, that becomes an emotional point for a lot of people as well. You know, but Dipinder, I want to talk to you. When you entered MasterChef, see, you can't really prepare for something like this. You won't know what you would be asked to cook in any given
day,
what the ingredients will be. But did you at least have a rough idea of how much you would want to play, say, with your Indian roots, and how much you would want to play Australian, or what your strengths will be, at least for the initial few weeks of the competition?
Honestly, I went into the show with one dish, which was my signature dish, which was kheva, with the gajar halwa ice cream. That's what I made. And after that point, I had basic skills, obviously cooking home style Indian food or cooking Indian food or curries. That comes naturally to me because I grew up eating that kind of food, and I've always been interested in cooking. So I always underestimated how powerful that, you know, that is. It's almost like a superpower that you can bring out Indian food every time you're in elimination, or every time you're in trouble, you can just pull it out. If it suits the challenge, why not? And I didn't expect to be making that much Indian food as much as I did on the show. I thought I would be doing a lot of cakes and baking and desserts because that's the kind of stuff that the judges would want to see. But I think the show just took off in a completely different tangent to what I anticipated when I first began. And like I said, I entered the show with one dish. I didn't have ideas. I mean, you have basic ideas that, oh, you can make a butter chicken, you can make a biryani, you can make a certain dishes. Yeah. But when it comes to suiting, you know, a challenge, you can't just make a dish, you know, without it hitting the brief in a way. So it's really important to do that as well. So that was, I think, the challenging part for me. But being on MasterChef was like an accelerated learning process as well. We're constantly learning about new techniques, new cuisines, new dishes that we've never experienced before. But yeah, I definitely didn't expect to be making that much Indian food as much as I did. But I think it worked in my favor. And I think, you know, I really enjoyed it as well.
Something that you've grown up eating, it's very comfortable, yeah, as well. Those are flavors, right, you have familiarity with as well. Absolutely. I want to talk about specific dishes now, because we had one particular episode of that green curry cake. I was like, is she really going to be able to pull that off? I mean, is that something that you hadn't heard of before? Because, you know, the other things that you did in terms of playing with smoked lassi or with the chicken that you made or biryani, these are still dishes that we've eaten, we've seen. But a green curry cake, what was the thinking that went behind it?
I've made that recipe once before, and I came across it when I was researching in terms of cakes and unique flavored cakes. And I think that dish really went with my style of cooking, because I love cooking South Asian and Southeast Asian food. And that was a side of baking that I had never seen. I love cooking desserts with a savory component. Like, I made a rosemary ice cream. So rosemary is traditionally a savory ingredient, which goes with lamb and beef and meats and those kind of things. And you don't see it being incorporated in desserts as much. So I loved that aspect of doing a savory dessert. And when I made this at home, I tasted it, and I was the only person that tasted it, and I was like, okay, this is good, but I don't know if the judges are going to like it. But when I saw that challenge, I was like, you know what, I'm just going to go in with this entirely. And I think the coconut ice cream, the coconut crumb, and the white choc chili ganache that I did on top, I think that they were all additions as I was building up the dish. I wanted to reinforce the Thai green curry flavor. So I was like, I have to add a coconut element to kind of just bring that dish together. And I think without any of those elements, that dish entirely would have been incomplete.
What was the learnings that you had with those experiences? Because those are ingredients and dishes that you've made before. Maybe you innovated a little more. But those specific elements like fire, that could have worked, that could not have worked. We all know it's very, very tricky to work with protein and fire. So how did you innovate to ensure the kind of feedback that you got at the end of the day?
I think there was no way of ensuring this. There was no guaranteed outcome that I would have had, because I have never cooked with fire before. And I said that on the show as well. Normally at home, my husband or, you know, my father-in-law, my dad, they do the barbecue side of things. And I do the marination, and I do, you know, all the doughs, and I do all the flavor side of things, but I don't actually stand there barbecuing stuff. That's their job. And we have a tandoor at home as well, and my husband uses that. I don't go near it because I'm too scared. So when the fire challenge came about, I was really excited, but I was really scared at the same time. Like, I'm really excited because I know I can put the flavor. Like, I know I know how to marinate a really nice tandoori chicken, and I know I can make like a nice dough of a naan. But how the hell am I actually going to cook this? So what I did, I took a lot of tips from Scott Pickett, who was the chef that was demonstrating that day. And I think that was really, that was kind of, you know, it played in all of our benefit, because I don't think any one of us played with fire, like open fire, because it's so temperamental. Yeah. And that night, the shooting, there was a lot of wind as well. So there's elements that you can control, and then there's elements that you can't. So I think the trick for me was the grill that I used to actually cook my chicken skewers. On one side, I asked for a lot of coals, so it was very hot, and the other side was cooler, a little bit less, so I could balance out. So I had both. So in case it was getting too hot, I would just move it to this side. And then I had a cooling rack on which I had some chilies, and I had some cabbage as well, which I wanted to serve as like, just like a charcoal salad, just like simple with a little bit of lemon juice, just to add that freshness to the dish as well. The smoked lassi was a huge experiment again, and that I added right at the end. I said to, like, I think Jock and Andy, and And Mel came over and they were like, so what are you cooking? I'm like, so I'm making this, but I'm also going to try and add a smoked element, because I think from what I learned from the demonstration before, smoking is like a flavor in itself. Like, you can add smoke as a flavor to any dish.
Is there a sense of regret that you have that maybe I should have stuck to more familiar things that I know, or do you not have a regret and felt like this is a competition, it could have gone either way?
I don't think I have major regrets, to be honest. I think the only thing that I think about looking back, you know, because hindsight's so interesting, is that, you know, it's really important to shake off the cooks that didn't go in your favor. For me, that was the cook which happened the day before, which was the team challenge. And for me, I felt extremely responsible for leading my team into an elimination. But at the same time, for me, going into the second cook, I probably should have, you know, been in a better mindset to be able to do whatever I wanted. But on the day, the ingredients that we got, I was very nervous in terms of cooking with Indian flavors, because, you know, it's very easy to overpower those native ingredients. And the whole show, the whole challenge was around native ingredients. Like, I mean, you know, the dish was, my only thing is, like, you know, the dish that I presented, the judges liked it. At least it wasn't a dish, you know, that was in any way, you know, kind of embarrassing, or they didn't enjoy it. It was a dish that I made and it worked. It was just, you know, not as good as maybe the other dishes that were presented.
Talk us about the relationships that you've formed with the friends that you've made. Some of your closest friends, who do you connect with the most?
I think some of my closest family, like my closest friends that I made, which I obviously now call family, they have to be my Sydney, you know, friends. And that is Tom, Dan, you know, Tommy, Linda, all those guys, and Jess as well. Like, we really, you know, came a long way throughout the show. And there were points where someone's having a really good cook and someone's having a really bad cook. So you have to balance out that stress level and that, you know, that atmosphere of tension. So when we used to come home, we used to have a dinner together every night, and we would just make something little or small. Sometimes we would just order out and just get takeaway. But most of the nights we would cook, and some nights, you know, if I don't feel like cooking, someone else will cook for me and I'll just eat. So it was overall, it was like a really good vibe and a really good atmosphere that we created for ourselves, purely because you need that, especially when you're away from family.
Dipinder, you know, before I wrap, because of time constraints, I have to ask you this. Was there any one particular dish that you wanted to make, but you couldn't because your time got over, and especially an Indian dish? And I also want to understand, now it's a cliched question, but I want to know, what from here on, what's next after MasterChef?
There are so many dishes that I wanted to make for the judges. Firstly, I really, really wanted to make an Indo-Chinese dish for them, which I couldn't make. The other dish that I really wanted to make was lal mas. It's one of my favorite dishes to make, and I make it at home, and I think I do a decent job. So I would have loved to make that for the judges, because it would have been a dish that would have been a totally different one to all of my other dishes that I've made. I think going, you know, coming out of MasterChef, you know, it's just opened so many opportunities for me. I think the one thing that I really want to do is write a cookbook, which I've already kind of started compiling, you know, my recipes, recipes that are my family recipes and recipes that I've learned and evolved as a cook with over the last few years. And I would love to see that in a book, you know, and that's kind of just showcasing our simple, humble Indian food that we make at home, and food that, you know, people don't, you know, when a guest is about to come to your house, immediately you start thinking of like fancy food. But when it comes to simple home food, if I get invited to someone's house, I want to eat what they eat every night. Like, I don't want to eat the fancy stuff. So that's the kind of food I want to showcase in my cookbook. And later down the track, I would love to open up, like, you know, an authentic Indian restaurant where I'm serving food that I like to cook. And it doesn't have to be something like big or a massive food chain. I would prefer it to be a very small niche restaurant, because I'd love to interact with every person that comes through my restaurant, because that's where my passion is. I want to see how much they're enjoying it, or if they are enjoying my food.
Dipinder, before I let you go, I know you're not going to tell me, the shooting is over, so you probably know who's won also. But with the contestants that are left and what we've seen on telly, who are you rooting for?
It's a really tough question, because I like every single one of them. I'm definitely rooting for Pete, because I know the caliber of his cooking, and I know what he can achieve, and, you know, what he deserves on the show. I obviously can't tell you who won officially, but yes. So I think every single one of them are full of surprises right now, and anyone can really take up the game. But I think my personal favorite will have to be Pete.
So Dipender is rooting for Pete. Dipender, this has been lovely. If we had a little more time, I would have loved to chat with you more, but this has been
thank you so
a pleasure.
Much.
Thank you so much for taking our time and doing this for us.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. It's been an absolute pleasure.